NWA said fuck the police. Now I'm in jail.
Mr. Mathers, Mr. Mathers, 15 seconds to curtain, Mr. Mathers.
Did you eat the spaghetti?
It's the Eminem Show with our very special guest star, Obi Trice.
What's the fat ass nut?
The Eminem Show is kind of like Return of the Jedi in the fact that it's often considered the worst in a brilliant trilogy, and yet despite that, it's my favorite in said trilogy. The first part of the trilogy is unbelievably impressive, and the second one was much darker and shook the landscape of what people expected. However, I feel that both Jedi and the Eminem Show are just so solid and near perfect that they end up being my favorite. Yeah, it may not be as impactful or respected as Empire, but it's got its own strengths that people ignore because of the Ewoks. Luckily though, I don't believe that the Eminem Show has its own form of Ewoks. Well, I mean, I guess it does have a song about AIDS.
What's the fat ass nut?
But perhaps I'm getting ahead of myself. This is my Slim Shady Retrospective, and today I'll be reviewing Star Wars Episode 6. I mean, the Eminem Show. Okay, so for starters, the cover is pretty decent in my opinion. Conceptually, it's pretty dull. I mean, it's just a reference to the album's opening skit, and it's not really worth talking about, but what I do like about the cover is its color palette. The way it mixes red, black, yellow, and white is really striking to me, and it catches my eye every time I see it. As far as the back cover, it's curtains. You then open up the case and more fucking curtains. They should have gotten scammed back again, blah 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 blah. So we pop in the CD and to our surprise, it doesn't actually open up with another public service announcement. Now personally, I think that this is for the best. You shouldn't have to open up every CD the same way out of obligation. And it kind of works too because of the differences between this album and the previous two. I mean, just look at the names. For the first album, you have the Slim Shady LP, then you have the Marshall Mathers LP, and then you have the Eminem Show, not the Eminem LP. With its different naming scheme and different presentation, I think it's fine to switch up the format of the intro too. You see, the Eminem Show is just fundamentally a different album than the first two. The Slim Shady LP was Marshall trying to prove himself while simultaneously providing an intro to the character of Slim Shady. The Marshall Mathers LP was a response designed to create as much controversy as possible. Whereas with the Eminem Show, it just seems like its priorities are just to make good music. You see, the Eminem Show has way more variety than the first two albums did. One song could be making a statement on controversy, the next could be a sweet song about his daughter, and then there could be a motivational anthem, and hell, while you're in it, just throw in a song about AIDS for good measure.
What's the fat ass nut?
This all feeds into the title of the album, The Eminem Show. This is a show, and each performance is different from the last, and it can do that. It's not confined to staying on theme like the first two albums. It instead decides to experiment around a little bit. And personally, I think this works in the album's favor. That being said, if you really want to see another public service announcement, then go listen to the beginning of the D12 album, Devil's Night. Now, with all that out of the way, what do I think of this replacement skit? Well, it's called Curtains Up, and it's definitely bare bones. Basically, what we can infer from the sound effects and the music is that we're staring at an empty stage, then Marshall rolls in on a wheelchair and grabs the mic, and then there's a little bit of silence before he starts to shout the opening line of the next song. Like I said, it's bare bones, but I think it works, and I think that it's the perfect note to begin the album on. The first song on the album is White America, and it's a great start. It puts you just in the right mood for the album. In the song, he criticizes his critics and talks about his increase in popularity, mainly coming from the fact that he's white. And to be fair, he's got a bit of a point. I mean, I can pop in the Chronic and listen to The Day the
Nigger
Took Over, and I may enjoy it well enough, but it's not like I'm going to relate to it in the same way that a black kid from the early 90s would. Likewise, I'd relate to something like Lil Dicky more than an urban person would, just because I grew up in a suburban environment. However, the thing is, Eminem managed to pull in both an urban and suburban audience. But the thing about that is, that exposure to suburban kids means exposure to suburban parents. You know who I'm talking about, the kind of parents that think The Simpsons is edgy. They hear Marshall's content, and this leads to massive controversy, which leads to massive popularity. More popularity leads to more exposure, which leads to more controversy, and the cycle goes on. That's not to say that Eminem's own skills didn't pull him through, but you can still get the point. He was on the rise, and every protest against him helped. I also love how the tone of this song is unclear. It's hard to tell if it's an angry song, a fun song, something that portrays gloating, or something that portrays self-deprecation. And to be honest though, it's probably all of that and more. I think this song is a great opener for the album, and I'm not sure if I can put my finger on why. I just think it works for whatever reason. The beat is great, the flow is great, Marshall brings a ton of energy this time around, and that energy is present throughout the entire album. I especially love how he closes the song with just a furious barrage of insults to America and to Lynn Cheney. Divided states of embarrassment will always be one of my favorite insults.
Fuck you, Miss Cheney! Fuck you, Tipper Boy! Fuck you with the freeze of speech this divided state of embarrassment will allow me to have! Fuck you!
I'm just playing, America. You know I love you.
The next song is Business, and it's pretty fucking dope. The song basically portrays Dr. Dre and Eminem as kind of a Batman and Robin, who are acting as the content cops of rap, so to speak. The song is fun, catchy, and just an overall crowd pleaser. I love the use of police sirens playing throughout the entire song during the beat, even if I have to check my rearview mirror every time I play this in my car. I also love the references to Adam West Batman thrown in throughout the song.
Holy whack, unlyrical lyrics, Andre! You're fucking right!
To the rap mobile.
Now to be honest, I always thought this song was an insane clown posse diss. It was mostly because of the allusions to clowns and the circus within the hook. I mean, M had a bit of a beef with them, so I just kind of assumed. But still, whether or not you read into it that way, this song is still pretty great. It's got a great beat, great flow, great humor, and it's just a lot of fun. The next song is Cleaning Out My Closet, and I have very mixed feelings about it. I mean, on one hand, it's a pretty decent song. It's got a good beat, decent rhymes, and it's very gritty and personal. But on the other hand, headlights. You see, this song is incredibly harsh towards his mother, and recently Marshall has made it very clear that he regrets making this song and other songs like it. And that's not too surprising when you listen to some of the attacks he dishes out in this song.
And Haley's getting so big now, you just see her, she's beautiful, but you'll never see her, she won't even be at your funeral.
Say what you will about his mother, but using Haley as a weapon is a pretty low blow. Also this line.
Take a second to listen before you think this record is dissing.
Okay.
You selfish bitch, I hope you fucking burn in hell for this shit.
Yeah, no. Still though, I'm not gonna act like this song is terrible or anything. In fact, at some points I really like it. This song is dark, and at some points it really works. For example, this line.
What I did was stupid, no doubt it was dumb, but the smartest shit I did was take the bullets out of that gun, cause I'd have killed him. Shit, I would've shot Kim and them both. It's my life, I'd like to welcome y'all to the Eminem show.
I love how we had two really fun songs, and then we finally get a title drop for the album once a really dark line hits. Overall though, it's still one of my lesser favorites on the album. I don't know, maybe I just don't get it. I mean, the last time I cleaned out my closet, Tom Cruise started freaking out and throwing coat hangers at me. Also, is it just me or does he not seem very sorry?
I'm sorry, mama. I never meant to hurt you.
The next song is Square Dance, and once again, it's another solid track. The whole song is a giant middle finger to George Bush, the draft, the Iraq War, and of course the people who try to censor this opinion. It may be political, but it's still a strong track. I love the beat for this song, and the flow and energy is pretty solid. It's not perfect though. Briefly in the third verse, Marshall starts to go full retard until he manages to pull it back together.
Gotta talk a lot of hum da la la la, uchi walla walla, da 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 da, but you gotta.
When I first heard the song, I hated the hook and the song in general, but since then it's really started to grow on me. It was just his accent that he did during the hook that really got on my nerves when I first heard it. But that being said, at least he only did the accent for one hook on one song on the album, and not for, say, I don't know, half of the fucking album. But I digress. Square Dance is another strong track and definitely worth checking out. Next! The next track is a skit called The Kiss, and to be honest, it's probably my favorite skit in an Eminem album. Not only is it entertaining in its own right, but it also enhances and improves the next song on the album. This skit is a reenactment of a situation that happened in real life, where Marshall pulled out an unloaded pistol in public and attacked a bouncer who Kim was cheating on him with. And since the next song on the album is M rapping about that situation, this skit is essential in helping the audience understand what's going on. And on top of all that, the skit somehow manages to still be hilarious. The banter between M and whoever he's talking to is hysterical.
Get out, fuck. Where are we going?
Get out!
The fuck, you want me to get under the car?
Who's she walking with?
Fuck, am I supposed to know? You told me to duck down.
Speaking of which, does anybody know who the guy in the car is actually supposed to be? If you know, leave an answer in the comment section below, and you could get a chance to win your very own Benoit balls.
Seriously, where the hell did I get these?
Anyway, last thing I'll mention about this skit is how the skit ends. When Marshall leaves the car, the music for the next song starts playing, and it builds up very nicely until it eventually explodes into the next song.
Kissing you, dog.
Fucking amazing. The next song is Soldier, and it's unbelievably good. Like I said before, it's a song about Marshall's assault case, and he brings up a couple of interesting points, like how the whole situation made him more credible as a gangster, despite the whole situation being unbelievably reckless and kind of hurting him in the eyes of the law. Throughout the song, he's surprisingly unapologetic, and this may have bugged me if it wasn't for the fact that the song is just so damn good. You have a creeping, intense beat, emphatic, angry verses, and then a calm and steady hook, and just great lyrical content. Overall, this song is just badass. However, there is one thing in the song I can't look past, and that's actually the title itself. Maybe I'm just an idiot, but I don't really get what any of this remotely has to do with being a soldier. I mean, a soldier would be someone who, like, fights for a cause, whereas in this case, M is just fighting because he's pissed. I don't know, maybe I'm missing something. Let me know in the comments if you know what I'm missing. Comment for a chance to win.
Like, seriously, I need to get rid of these.
These ain't old bees.
And now, a letter to Paul Feig. The next song is Say Goodbye to Hollywood, and I'm gonna be honest, it's one that I tend to gloss over. Not really because it's bad, but just for whatever reason, I just don't listen to it as much as some of the other tracks. It definitely doesn't stand out as well as some of the other tracks on the album, but I would say that it's still definitely a good track. It's got a good beat, some decent rhymes, and a pretty depressing theme. Basically, the song is Marshall rapping about how tired he is from creating music, working on 8 Mile, and falling out with Kim again. He even gets to a point where he's saying really depressing shit like this.
If I could swallow a bottle with Tylenol, I would, and hit it for good, just say goodbye to Hollywood.
Overall, the song is good. Not great, but good. The one thing I'm not big on, though, is that the hook is pretty much just the same line repeated over and over again. I struggled to think of a single time that that has ever worked.
I got a hand on my gas! I got a hand on my gas! I got a hand on my gas! I hand on my gas! I got a hand on my gas!
This song is gross. I mean, just look at the fucking title. Nothing says family-friendly fun like a song named Drips. Oh, you know, Billy, Drips, like, rain. It's all part of the water cycle.
Round and around, vapor goes up and the rain comes down. Water in the sky, in the ocean, in the ground. It's all in a cycle going round and round.
What's the fat-ass nut?
Yeah, this song is about AIDS. And you know, little Billy knows a thing or two about that.
Oh, baby!
Now, it may sound like I'm bashing this song, but to the contrary, I actually love it. The beat is great, the verses are solid, the hook is catchy, and it doesn't hurt that it features Obie Trice, who is one of my favorite rappers.
Even though you wouldn't guess that from his guest verse here.
His verse here isn't bad, but it's too explicit. And no, I don't mean the, oh, mom and dad will have a fit kind of way. I'm talking about the, there are certain things that a man and a woman should keep to themselves kind of way. Basically, in his verse, he has sex with a woman and winds up getting AIDS. It sounds simple, but you better bet that he's going to go into as much detail as fucking possible.
Foaming at the lips, the ones between the hips. Pubic hairs looking like some sour cream dip. Without the nacho, my dick hit the spot though. Pussy tighter than conditions of us black folks. Me in the final stretch, the last part of sex, I bust a fat ass nut.
Sweet Jesus. I don't care what your ideological beliefs are. There is no justification for conceptualizing the words bust a fat ass nut in your head. Harambe did not die for this. This song makes me never want to have sex ever. Not that that's gonna be any kind of a problem.
Aha!
And then we have M's verse, which is taken in a very different direction. Basically, he finds out that his wife has been cheating on him and she gave him AIDS.
To enjoy 2 AIDS before each meal. Mmm, delicious chocolate flavor.
His verse is very angry and very hilarious. Probably the best line in the song would have to be,
so you take back home, cause you gon' get that hoe. When you see it, you gon' bend her fucking neck back, yo, cause you love her.
For some unexplained reason, I just love this song, and I listen to it every time I put in the album. Fair warning though that not everybody is going to have this same reaction to it. Alright, one last time for the road.
What's the fat ass nut?
Okay, so I know it sounds a little bit drastic, but I'm pretty sure that Without Me is my favorite Eminem single. That's right, I think I like it even more than The Real Slim Shady. And don't get me wrong, I love The Real Slim Shady, but Without Me is just so damn good. This is probably my favorite Eminem song to karaoke to. There's just something about the flow, the beat, and the content all coming together in the song that just plain works. I honestly don't have much to say about this one. It's just fun, catchy, and hits all the right ticks for me. Not to mention, it's just my favorite to sing to. I should probably also mention that this is one of the few Eminem songs where I actually really like the music video. Especially the ending where Dre and M break into that kid's house.
Kids!
Like I said, Without Me is just one of my favorites, plain and simple. Next up is a Paul Rosenberg skit, and honestly, it's just okay. In it, Paul is basically just yelling at M for bringing his gun out in public after his assault charge. It does a decent job of leading into the next song, but it's not really on the same level as The Kiss. Still though, it does its job, it's short, and overall, it's okay. The next song is Sing for the Moment, and I know I sound like a broken record, but once again, it's really fucking good. In this song, Marshall talks about his critics and censors, his assault charges, his music, and what all of it means to his listeners. This is all complemented by the hook, which uses a generous and well-placed sample of Dream On by Aerosmith. The beat does a great job of complementing the sample, much like Stan did. Also like Stan, the final verse of the song is a very powerful message from Marshall to his fans. I swear, every time I listen to those final few lines of the song, I get goosebumps.
While we sing for these kids who don't have a thing, except for a dream and a fucking rat magazine, who post pinup pictures on their walls all day long, idolize their favorite rappers and know all their songs, or for anyone who's never been through shit in their lives, so they sit and they cry at night, wishing they died, so they throw on a rap record and they sit and they vibe with nothing to you, but with the fucking shit in their eyes. That's why we seize the moment, try to freeze it and own it.
Overall, I just don't really have any problems with this song, nor do I have much to say on it. It's just powerful and well produced, and then what more could you ask for? The next song is Superman. No, not that one. Not that one. Not that one. There he is.
There he is!
Superman is a pretty okay song. I mean, if nothing else, it at least sounds good. It has a good beat and a great use of an acoustic guitar. The rapping is solid and the hook is catchy. The only problem with the song is the actual content of what he's talking about. You see, this is a bitches ain't shit kind of song, and I've dealt with enough bullshit from women to make me love a good bitches ain't shit song.
I got these for you!
The problem is that in most bitches ain't shit type songs, the rapper's supposed to be complaining about how said bitch fucked him over. The problem is, in this song, the bitches Marshall talks about aren't really doing anything wrong. In the situations he's describing, he's the asshole in the situation. This makes it hard to relate, sympathize, and get cathartic with the song. Then again, I'm probably overthinking it. Honestly, I really like this song, and I listen to it pretty much every time I put on the CD. There's one line that really sticks out beyond the others, though.
Put anthrax on a Tampax and slap you till you can't stand.
Now, I don't have a vagina.
Could've fooled me.
Shut the fuck up! Now, I may not have a vagina, but even I cross my legs when I hear this line. But since I am a toxic man, I decided to ask some of my female friends what they thought about the line.
Hey, Hagen, what's your opinion on the whole anthrax in your Tampax thing?
What the fuck did you just say to me?
Next track, next track!
And now the answer you've all been waiting for. Can Eminem sing?
We're no strangers to love. You know the rules, and so do I.
I can't sing.
I like this song. It's sweet. And yeah, no, Marshall is definitely a rapper and not really a singer. But that being said, every once in a while, he does get it right, and Haley's song, I believe, is one of those cases. It's not great singing, but it's definitely some of the best he's given us, and it definitely works for the song. Haley's song is appropriately enough a song dedicated to his daughter Haley. The song starts out with Marshall saying,
"Yo, I can't sing, but I feel like singing. I wanna fucking sing, cause I'm happy. Yeah, I'm happy. I got my baby back. Yo. Check it out."
And that pretty much sets the mood for the entire song. From there we get two amateur but sincere and heartfelt sung verses from M, until the third verse where he switches back to rap and brings it back with the hook. The song is just designed to make you feel good, which is very different from every other song he made at the time. A song like this never could have survived on the first two albums, but due to the Eminem Show's diversity, it fits right in here. The song is incredibly happy, incredibly heartfelt, and occasionally fun. It's not perfect though. Due to the different tone of this song, some of the things Marshall says in this come off as really hypocritical. This line in particular really rubs me the wrong way.
People make jokes, cause they don't understand me. They just don't see my real side.
Oh! People made jokes about you? Aw, honey, do you need a hug? Oh, wait.
Smith don't got a cuss in his raps to sell records. Well, I do, so fuck him and fuck you too.
Yeah, no, you're full of shit. I think this line would have been better if he said something along the lines of, "People hate my guts, cause they don't understand me. They just don't see my real side.
I can't sing."
But I digress. Regardless of a few awkward lines, this song is beautiful and heartwarming. At least until I ruin it for you. If you don't want this song butchered for you beyond relief, skip to the time listed on the screen. Okay, so imagine this song being a sequel to Kim and 97 Bonnie and Clyde. Not so sweet, huh? Not so sweet, huh? Not so sweet, huh? Don't worry about it. Be happy. Steve Berman skit, and it's pretty good. Now, for those of you who don't remember, there was a skit on Marshall Mathers LP called Steve Berman, and then this skit in this album kind of flips it on its head. And in that sense, I think it really works. I also really think that it works after Haley's song, given how Haley's song is a really upbeat and different kind of song that Berman would very likely have little of a problem with. The skit also does a decent job of transitioning into the next song, so overall, I think it works. Okay, next we got When the Music Stops, which is a D12 song, and I'd say it's pretty good. For once, everyone has a strong verse, including Bizarre, and I'd say that Con Artist sticks out among them as the best. Surprisingly, I'd say that Proof, of all people, had probably the worst verse. It's not bad, but it's just that the other verses are better. It seems like everybody else is rapping about something in particular, whereas Proof is just kind of rapping about being a gangster, which is pretty much just every other D12 song ever, so I don't know. That being said, I like how there's no hook, and instead each verse just ends with the same words, when the music stops. The beat is good, albeit not great, and as per usual, each member of D12 brings a different flow to the song. The only real problem I have with the song is the same problem I have with a lot of D12 songs, and that's that everyone seems to be talking about something completely different. Most D12 songs seem to be incredibly unfocused. The only reason why I think that it may work in this song is that every verse revolves around the words, when the music stops, and each of the six artists takes that line and wraps a verse around what that line means to them. The only problem with this is that in one verse you'll have con artists rapping about his insecurities.
I was happy having a deal at first. Thought money would make me happy, but it only made my pain worse.
And then in another, you'll have Bizarre talking about exaggerated reactions to popular music artists.
NWA said fuck the police, now I'm in jail.
Now don't get me wrong, I like both of these verses, but they just don't mesh well. However, I still like the song despite all that, and overall I say it's just another success to add to the Eminem Show's track record.
Funny joke!
Oh, and one last thing, I love the ending for this song.
Voices in my head, I'm going in shock. I'm reaching for the clock, but the music stopped.
The next song is Say What You Say, and it's actually probably my least favorite track on the album. It's a collaboration between Dr. Dre and M, but there's nothing particularly memorable or interesting about this song, in my opinion. It's not a bad song, but there's nothing that really sticks out to me, and I always end up skipping it. I mean, the only thing that I ever really wind up remembering about it is that at one point M rhymes the words Mrs. Buttersworth with the words What It's Worth, and yeah. On top of all that, I just find the beat a little bit uninteresting, and I find the hook kind of lazy.
What you say is what you say. Say what you say, how you say it, whenever you saying it. Just remember how you said it when you were spraying it. So who you playing with, huh?
Like I said, it's not a bad song, but it's just one I tend to skip every time.
Sometimes you just feel tired. You feel weak. And when you feel weak, you feel like you want to just give up. You gotta search within you. Try to find that inner strength and just pull that shit out of you. And get that motivation to not give up and not be a quitter.
Till I Collapse is god tier. It's easily in my top 3 Eminem songs, and it's easily one of my top 5 favorite songs, period. Everything about this song works. This is my motivational song. This song starts out with just an atmospheric opening, sampling Requiem for a Dream, and we get Marshall giving a little pep talk about getting up instead of giving up, all with an army marching in the background. This eventually all builds up into the first verse. And with these verses, M is on fire. He is attacking the mic, and his aggressive passion never fails to get me pumped. All of his verses in the song are god tier. Great rhymes, great flow, and intense energy. Each of these verses build up to the hook, which is sung by the greatest vocalist of all time, Nate Dogg. As expected, Nate Dogg kills it by doing what he does best, playing it smooth and letting his godly vocal cords do the rest. In this song, M's aggressive verses and Nate Dogg's smooth chorus complement each other better than any other song I've ever seen. For the life of me, I'll never understand why this isn't a single. In fact, what's up with the singles on this album? I mean, Without Me, that makes sense. Sing for the Moment, I'm okay with that. Clean Out My Closet, I don't really get it. It's kind of awkward, it's a bitter song about his mom, not sure about that. And Superman, really? I mean, the fact that Superman is a single, and yet Till I Collapse, White America, Soldier, and Business are not, it just boggles me. But anyway, back to Till I Collapse. I don't really have any big problems with the song. I mean, maybe this line.
I'll probably never get the props I feel I ever deserve.
I mean, you have to understand, this came out in 2001, and Slim Shady was on top of the fucking world. Then again, this line may also be him saying that he'll never be satisfied no matter how big he gets. Either way though, it's no big deal because this song is a goddamn masterpiece and it's easily the best song on the album. The final song on the album is My Dad's Gone Crazy, and I'm not exactly sure why, but I believe that this is the perfect song to end the album on. It's a song that basically features Haley as she repeatedly says the line, "My dad's gone crazy." Now, for the first two verses and for the hook, this song is just hilarious and fun, with some really great lines thrown in.
Like my mother always told me. Nothing nice to say, then don't say no.
However, then the third verse switches everything up, and the beat changes, and the song just goes quite a bit more serious. One line in particular stands out among the rest.
More pain inside of my brain in the eyes of a little girl inside of a plane aimed at the World Trade, standing on Ronnie's grave, screaming at the sky till clouds gather. It's Clyde Mathis and Bonnie Jake.
Now, we can make 9/11 jokes today, no problem.
The movie's called September 11th, 2000 Fun.
But you have to keep in mind that this song came out 1 year after the World Trade attacks, and this was the ballsy thing to mention through and through. Does that make this a good thing, bad thing? I don't know. I also love the line that the song ends on.
And that's pretty much the gist of it. Parents are pissed, but the kids love it. 9mm heaters stashed in two-seaters with meat cleavers. I don't blame you, I wouldn't let Haley listen to me neither.
I just feel like that's just the perfect note to end the album on. I mean, it gives off the edgy feeling of Eminem, but it also is kind of fun and lighthearted. Much like the whole album. Overall, it's just a solid ending.
Crazy.
You're funny, Daddy.
And so we close the album with an ending skit entitled Curtains Close, in which Ken Keniff walks up onto the empty stage and starts making sex jokes. Now this album is quite a bit more lighthearted, like I mentioned, so I think that this is an okay note to end the album on. It's stupid, but I kinda like it.
Where'd everybody go? Guess who's back? Back again. Ken is back. Tell some men, rub my back.
And so that was the Eminem Show. All in all, I'd say it's a home run. The best songs on the album would definitely be Till I Collapse, Without Me, and Soldier. Much like the Slim Shady LP, I don't believe that there's a single bad song in the album. However, if I had to choose, I'd say that my least favorite would definitely be Say What You Say. Overall, the Eminem Show is just borderline perfect. While it's certainly not as much of a landmark as the first two albums, it's still my favorite to listen to out of the three. Between the Slim Shady LP, the Marshall Mathers LP, and the Eminem Show, the Eminem Show is just the one I'm most likely to put on in my car. It's not really an album based in concepts, but it's just that the songs themselves are just individually good. I feel like in his first two albums, Marshall was trying to prove himself, whereas in the Eminem Show, he's just trying to make good music, and I think he succeeds. There's so many solid tracks on this album that it's just impossible not to like it. With three major successes under his belt, Marshall was on top of the fucking world. He had cemented himself as a rap god, and he proved his unwavering skill and talent.
God help us all.